How is everyone? How is everyone? Depressed? Great. That's great. I'm here actually to help those who are dispirited and depressed. That is my mission in life. So join the club and let me share some friendship and advice with dispiritedness and depression. It's actually a very, very good thing. It's a blessing. If you can look at it that way, it takes the sting out of it. What depression and dispiritedness is really you're putting the brakes on. You're braking. You're slowing down, which is a very, very great thing. So don't get trapped in hating yourself for slowing down. But we think, oh, I'm going to miss the future. I'm going to miss all these things. Well, ask yourself, has anything ever given you what you really wanted? Anything at all? Has there been anything or combination of things that has given you what you really wanted? Now, I can say for myself, no, not a single thing ever in my life has ever given me what I wanted. Not one thing. Nothing. So, why do I want to continue on with things? With thingness? So, if you're going along a road, let's say in the wrong direction, and there's a road hazard up ahead, and you see it and whoa, going off a cliff or something, and you say, I need to turn, there's a side road here, I need to turn off here to avoid going into this cataclysm. Now, if you're going really fast on that road, you know, you're going 80, 85, 90, how can you turn off the road? You can't. You'll flip over. So you better slow down. You better slow down. You better hit the brakes. And of course, when you hit the brakes, you're going to feel, oh, I'm slowing down. I'm not going fast. I need to go fast to get to where I want to go. I'm going to miss out. I'm not going to be, you know, I'm a loser. I'm going slow. No, you're not a loser. Because when you see that side road, you'll say, oh, okay, let me hit the brakes a little more and make a nice 15-mile-an-hour turn right onto the side road, and you go off on the side road and you say, oh my gosh, it's so beautiful here, it's wonderful. You avoid the catastrophes, you avoid the cataclysms. You turn away from the future. Now, what is the future? We're in a situation where we're trying to forget reality. So it's like we've fallen asleep in reality and we're dreaming a dream of forgetfulness. We call this dream the future. And the future is so that there we can look that there's a past, that reality is past. How can there be a past unless there's a future? So we are constantly engage in what we call moving into the future, leaving the past behind, leaving something behind. And so that's why we're driving so fast. Why are we driving so fast? We're leaving the past behind. Where we are, we're leaving it behind. Now, when you start slowing down, you say, oh my gosh, I'm not leaving all this terrible stuff behind, you know, all these things I don't like. And so we think that if we go faster, we're leaving all those things behind that we don't really want. But what are we doing as the faster we go? The more future we are getting into, which is a dream of forgetfulness. We're trying to forget reality so we can be creators of a new reality. I know this is all a little sketchy, but just bear with me because it has to do with depression. Depression is braking. You're slowing down. Hit the brakes. You're hitting the brakes. Now, something very interesting. What one of the greatest helps this world has ever had is Sri Ananda Maima in India, 1897 to what, 1980, 82, and very interesting. If you notice, those who've been around it the longest, are they happy? No, they look very depressed, actually, very morose, very serious, very depressed. And amazed, they say, "Wow, maybe this is no help. Why? What help? They should be bubbly and happy and joyful and all this stuff." No, they were not. Why? Why? Because they were hitting the brakes. They were slowing down. When you do this, a mood of sort of depression comes upon you. And you're kind of agitated and angry. I was certainly that way this morning, saying, "Ah, I just want to die, forget it, you know, there's nothing to live for here." Well, no things are worth living for, actually. The future is not, the time, future, which then automatically supposes a past, is not worth living for at all. It's not life at all, it's a fantasy of non-life, actually. The thing is, these great teachers, these great helpers, friends, these great friends that we have, they don't need us to be happy. You don't have to be like, you know, I'm feeling the ecstasy, I'm feeling joy, oh yes, I'm so wonderful, I'm so happy. They don't need that at all. They don't need us to be happy. It's perfectly okay for them if you're very depressed and very morose and very serious. It's fine, because they know that means you're hitting the brakes. What they help with is that you don't get into a suicidal state of mind, because that's what the ego tells you. The goddess of commerce, goddess of the flesh, goddess of forgetfulness, goddess of the future, making the future look so attractive, things, making things look so attractive, making the superficiality, the glitter of the future, the goddess of glitter. She says you should kill yourself because you're going to miss out on all this. Isn't that terrible? It's just a shameful thing. It's better that you die than to live and not be part of this wonderful future party we're having. So that's the problem. When you can turn that aside, then your depression is transformed, actually, into something very beneficial and helpful. And you don't look at yourself as dispirited. It changes. You look at yourself as very fortunate. Thank God for this slowdown. Thank God for the slowdown. You know, this is wonderful. It's a great blessing. It changes. And then the clouds of saying, "I just want to die," those dissipate. They don't come from truth, reality at all. They come from the ego, because the ego knows that you're on the right track, and it wants to stop you from being on the right track. It wants to end your depression. The ego, see, the problem as you slow down, the ego wants to end that slowdown. So it tries to make you slow down too fast, maybe, and that freaks you out. You say, "Oh, come on, just stop right now." It freaks you out. Then you feel, "Oh, I just want to die." Or it tries to make you feel ashamed of slowing down. Or it tells you you're going to miss so much by slowing down that your life is not even worth living, and all this kind of stuff. Those are the lies and deceptions that cause us to feel so painfully depressed. The suffering we call depression is an egoic interpretation of your slowdown. All right. So sometimes when friends come into this world, when they say, "Everybody, hey, slow down, slow down," the world, the ego attacks them and puts them into a severe depression, saying how wrong you are to try and slow this down. This is some horrible thing. And then that's what happened to me. You know, terrible, terrible, terrible depression. Because the ego insisted on its interpretation, you know, of what the slowdown is. This is the ego's interpretation. Oh, it's this horror. You'll be horribly depressed. Not at all. you'll actually start feeling real hope and say, this is great. Oh, I can repent. I can recognize my mistakes. When I slow down, I can recognize my mistakes. When I slow down, I can turn off. I can turn off on a safe bypass road, a detour road around disasters. When I slow down, I can remember, hey, this is just a fantasy of forgetfulness that claims it's the future. And claims, therefore, that reality is in the past. All these totally bogus claims. And you start getting wise. Is what happens when you slow down. You start getting wisdom. The people who are frantically speeding up, more things, the wisdom is evaporating for them. They're becoming morons. Really. The wisdom is evaporating for them. So the ego tries to demonize your slowdown and get you to accept its interpretation of it. And that's where the pain, real painful depression comes in. You feel like, oh, I'm missing out on everything. Everybody's leaving me behind and all this stuff. What is the future leaving behind? The past? What is the past? Does right now, does reality, does everywhereness have a past? There's no past. There's no future either. There's no future, no past. There's no time at all. Time implies forgetfulness, really. Leaving something behind us. It's not reality at all. So, one of the best things is to realize you don't have to be happy to actually get right teaching. That's something I always worry about. Like, I can't go to any teachers because I'm so depressed or so morose, or, you know, I'm not happy at all. In fact, just the opposite. Extremely unhappy with things, with this perception of thingness, of gaps, perception of gaps, which means perception of thingness. It's never given me anything. So how can you go to a teacher when you're so cranky and so down and stuff? You think, like, no, you're supposed to, like, say, hey, I'm successful. Yeah, I got a good job. I'm successful. I'm happy. I'm engaging the world. I'm following my joy. I'm joyous. I'm loving and all this stuff. And you know, and it's like, or else a teacher say, well, what's wrong with you? You know, so a lot of teachers want you to simply reflect back to them, feed off your energy, like, they want you to be happy around them so they can be happy. And if you're really morose, they'll say, ah, you're bringing me down. That's not good. You're bringing me down. But the real teachers cannot be brought down by any of that. Their state is totally steady. Doesn't matter, come sun, come rain. Doesn't affect them at all. So, you know, a lot of teachers, they want all their devotees to show the world how happy they are, so the world can think that the teacher is really happy too. And they're not, of course. They are using the students, the devotees, to try to give the world the impression that they're happy, and they think that that's the thing that they want, is the opinion of the world, is the thing that they're lacking. Whereas real teachers don't care at all about the opinion of the world, as far as any way, regard whatsoever. That doesn't mean that they're immoral or do crazy things. No. It means that they don't care if the world looks at those who are around them and their devotees, and they're very unhappy. The devotees are unhappy. They're kind of serious and downcast and all this kind of stuff. They don't care. If the world says, oh, they can't be any good teacher. Look, the students don't seem to be happy. They don't care. They don't care at all. They're not looking for an opinion. They're not looking for a thing. Not even an opinion. They know that hitting the brakes is very good. Now, in my life, I've been saved from severe depression by some great teachers who somehow gradually got me to reinterpret what's going on. And I'm still, you know, on the edge of depression. Very morose and of course just hating the situation here. Absolutely, it's just terrible. The future looks just utterly awful, actually. And that's depressing. It seems depressing. However, if you can positively break, say, okay, I'm breaking, that's good. I'm slowing down. We'll be able to see, what's the alternative? What's the option to the future right now? It's the nowness, the oneness, the vision of oneness is the alternative to time, to the future. And again, time means the future leaving the past. That's what it is. When we wanted to forget reality, how could we forget something? Obviously, we have to leave it in the past. Leave it, you know. In order to forget something, there has to be a thing, right? So we objectified reality as a thing that we're leaving. So it's like we look back there and say, oh yeah, it's far away. And then as we're traveling, it's receding more and more and more into the called the past, you know, distant in the distant past. And as we go into the future, it recedes even more into the distant past. That's our fantasy. But the vision of oneness doesn't see anything receding or leaving, because everything is in the same. It's like all the fish are in the ocean. No matter where the fish are swimming in the ocean, right? All the fish are swimming in the ocean, doing all sorts of stuff. But none of them are leaving the ocean. They're all still in the one same ocean. And the ocean actually is one, isn't it, around the world? The Pacific joins the Atlantic around tip of Tierra del Fuego, tip of South America, right? And then there's the Antarctic area there. And then the Atlantic goes into what, the Indian Ocean, and then the Indian goes into eventually the Pacific Ocean. It's all one big ocean. And all the fish are in that ocean. They're not leaving the ocean. So nothing is leaving pure spaciousness. There's no future. There's no past. There's no leaving. There's no gap. Like the past, future and past and time is like a gap. Like say, oh, the gap is getting bigger and bigger. Look at the gap. The past is over there and we're here. And so there's a gap there. There's a gap. We see space as gaps. Like I'm here, the tree's over there. There's a gap between us. Really? Well, it's like a fish looking at another fish and say, there's a gap there. And then we say, no. All fish are in the same ocean. There's just one ocean. It's all H2O. there's no real gap as far as where you're at. You're in the ocean. The same ocean. Same water. H2O. It's a shift in perception that we are aiming for. The vision of oneness is what we're aiming for. And Ananda Maima did say, nobody can be saved except that they have the vision of oneness. It's absolutely prerequisite. And Jesus said the same thing in the Course in Miracles. Vision of oneness, he calls it vision of Christ, vision of oneness. Everybody, you have to have that. You have to have it. So, Jesus, what did Jesus say? He came, I come to the those who are dispirited, right? Those who are poor in spirit. Blessed are those who are poor in spirit. I came to save the sinners, meaning those who are poor in spirit. Exactly. Meaning those that are breaking, putting on the brakes, slowing down, not pursuing all the thingness in the future, not trying to make the gap greater, the perceived gap greater. They're saying, I've had enough of this, let's slow down so we can turn off this terrible highway of hell. So be glad that you're not happy. Be glad that you're not happy, absolutely. You're not aiming for happiness, you're aiming for bliss. The bliss of vision of oneness, the bliss of seeing no gaps. The bliss of the timelessness, the vision of timelessness. It's all the same. There's no gaps. How can there be time? How can anything be, if nothing's leaving anything else, how can there be time? How can there be a future and a past? How can anything be past? Nothing. It's different than you know. It's different than it is now. Now it's one way, but in the past it was different. None, how can that be possible? No, everything has always been within pure spaciousness. There can never be a situation where it's not. So how can you talk about some past that's different in that regard? Appearances can constantly change, but there all these appearances arise in the pure spaciousness. So I've always been a friend to people who are depressed and downcast, but what happened was I got caught up in that and started empathizing and actually feeling the depression myself, which is not right, because the depression is just a slowing down, and it's a misinterpretation of slowing down. But once you've slowed down and gotten off this terrible road to hell, then you're in the steady state of bliss. That's the goal. So you don't want to stop showcasing the goal. Otherwise, people lose their motivation. So that's not good at all. It's just that I succumb to the ego's pressure, you know, to view depression, view slowing down as a negative thing. The slowdown has to be profound. It has to be profound. It has to be. You have to be alert. You have to be use expedience every day. You have to embrace the challenge of slowing down. You have to withstand the pressure. I don't know if there's any more pressure in the world than the Silicon Valley, which is just. For the future, this is the most pressure there is here. Terrible, terrible. Embrace the challenge of slowing down. And the slowing down is not necessarily physiological, body moving, not that sort of slowing down necessarily. Although sometimes that can help meditation or just sitting quietly. It's very helpful. It's a slowing down in a deeper way of clarification, clear delineation, dispassionate delineation of, wow, the future, the past. It's like I said in another video, I haven't posted it yet, but so I'll have to do that. But I said, when we want to have more than everything, automatically we assume there's a automatically that comes with the corollary that it's possible to have less than everything, automatically. Because if you put more than everything as a possibility, that means if you don't have more than everything, you're actually having less than what you could have. So that's duality right there in a nutshell. And so we're in the situation we feel we have less than we could have. And so we embrace thingness, thinking that this is the more that we need to get. We say that the lack of thingness, we say we see everything, we have everything, and we want to have more than everything. How can we have more than everything? By seeing thingness, gaps. Believing there's gaps in these things that are separate. We say we get that, then we'll have more than everything. And if we don't get that, we'll have less than what we want, and therefore, we should feel deprived. So we carry this feeling of deprivation with us. Duality automatically has this feeling of deprivation, automatically, instantaneously, automatically. As soon as we have this idea, let's have more than everything, the feeling of deprivation arises immediately. And we think, oh my gosh, I'm going to miss out. I'm going to be deprived. I'm going to be lacking. And so let's get things, we need to acquire things. And of course, then we eventually find ourselves with this human body that is very adept at making things and getting things and, you know, hoarding things and going through things. And we think, okay, this is progress. This is working on our deprivation. Now, if you start slowing down in this, you start, then the fear of deprivation starts grabbing you and you start feeling depressed. Like, I'm going to be deprived. Of course, there isn't any more than everything. Never has been. All these so-called things, there are no gaps. They're not things at all. There are no things. So we're afraid to see no thingness, the vision of no thingness. Because we'll feel that we'll be deprived then, but there's nothing to get. We can't have more than everything. Of course not. But just noticing this is super helpful. If there's no things, how can we get things? How can we get more than everything? Or more than the oneness, more than reality, which includes all appearances? How can we get more than that if there aren't any gaps, aren't any things? We cannot. So we want to see things, gaps between, gaps, separation, fragmentation, so we can feel we can add what is more than reality. And we can have more than everything, more than reality. And of course, when we slow down, we're not, you know, getting so much, don't have money to go places, do things, acquire things, buy things again, and we feel, start to get depressed, like I'm going to be deprived, I'm going to be really deprived. The future is one of deprivation. Well, as far as getting things, yes, but we can have the vision of oneness, and we realize that there are no things. So how can we be deprived? There are no things to get. Where is the deprivation? And again, don't try to grasp it too much. Any teaching is like a flower. Let's say you have this beautiful plant and it produces this beautiful bloom, beautiful flower. Just sit there and just enjoy it. And every now and then you get the fragrance. That's a nice fragrance. And then maybe you won't smell it for a little while. And then the breeze takes it to you and you get some more fragrance. And you look at the beauty of the flower swaying a little in the breeze. And it's so beautiful. It's just like that. That's what it's like. Catching the fragrance. So you just spend time and you try to pick up on the fragrance, and your mind is still quiet, still. You want to smell the fragrance of it. Don't try to pick it. See, that is the problem that people say. They say, I'm going to add this to my collection of things. This will make it happy. No. They say, don't kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. Exactly. So those who want to possess this flower, they're not on the spiritual path. They're not on the path of towards the vision of oneness. They're still trying to get more than everything. So they see it as a thing to be gotten, to be acquired. And their business instincts come in. Okay, how can I acquire this? How can I get this? How can I add this to my wardrobe? And they think the people just sitting there are stupid. You know, they're kind of a little bit downcast, a little depressed. You know, just, I always look at these stupid people. Why don't they cut the flower and bring it inside? Get it for themselves. Why are they just letting it sit there? Why are they just sitting there? Stupid people, you know. So don't think you have to be happy to catch the fragrance of the flower. Absolutely not. In fact, sort of a downcast, quiet, downcast mood of repentance is what's helpful. And of course, all your dreams of acquiring things are sort of falling apart, collapsing, because you're saying, my God, I'm not pursuing a path of riches here in the world. And my prospects are looking very dim for the few, as far as getting things, you know, for me, definitely. In fact, the prospects are so dim, they're dark. They're pitch dark. The future for me is like pitch dark. as far as acquiring things, getting things, getting worldly success. People look and say, oh, you're successful. Pitch dark. So that can lead to sort of depression, like, oh my gosh, how can I ever be successful? How can I get what I want? Well, what we really want is the vision of oneness. And in order to do that, you have to slow down. You have to slow down. Now, we look at those who are in spiritual traditions, religious traditions, etc. We think, okay, they must be succeeding, etc. But what they're getting is a role, a degree, a title, all this stuff. Those are still things. Very rarely do you see someone actually succeed in the vision of oneness in those situations, in any situation. There are difficulties and traps there too. Just being a renunciate, that can be a status also. The hardest thing is to function in the world and at the same time slow down, put the brakes on, and accept the vision of oneness. Because when you function in the world, you don't have any status, religious status, you don't have any religious degree, you don't have people bowing to you, you don't have anything, you got nothing. So that's the path I've been on. And it's like very difficult, but very effective. As people look at me and say, oh, you know, prosperous middle class person, no problems, you know. And it's like, wow. Whereas if I had the ochre robes on and the shaved head, and people say, oh yeah, renunciate, holy person, go on the path of God, that's wonderful. And can we, you know, and you're in the temple, you have all the sangha around you, you have all these things, all these situations. And you think, well, why do I need to hit the brakes entirely here? Why do I need to slow down too much? I got all this, you know, I got status, and people respect me, and all this stuff. People come, they smile, they're so happy to see me, and they ask for blessings, they ask my blessings, I give them my blessings, and wow, I'm you know, isn't this wonderful? But for me, nobody asks my blessings for anything. Nobody sees me as anything. So that puts a real strain on you, that's a fast path. So paradoxically, my teachers have kept me on this path, which is so difficult, because it really slows down. There's nothing to grab a hold of. So you may be in the same boat. You say, where's my status? I don't have any status. I don't have any future status in the future. And then you catch the fragrance of this flower that's there. I should throw up a flower here, probably. And you say, oh good, it's not so bad. It's not as bad as I thought. It's just the ego thinks it's terrible. The ego says, you're ruined. You're in ruination. Terrible, terrible, terrible. You'll never get what you really want. I say, no, ego, I will get what I really want, which is to drop this insane, whimsical, absurd quest for more than everything. This quest did accomplish the impossible, to separate from reality, to be the new prime creator, all that stuff, which causes nothing but fear of deprivation. I'll be free of that. And the ego says, no, the fear of deprivation is necessary to drive you to attain. Now, all you attain is just more fear of deprivation. You look at the wealthy people. I happen to be around the wealthy people a lot, and as a lowly slave, and they're not happy. They're concerned, they're perplexed, they don't want to part with their money. They're struggling, they say, I need more things. They're just very aggressive in getting things, because they're have a severe fear of deprivation if they don't. I have a problem now where like I don't even want to take money for anything, because people want it so desperately more than I do. I certainly need it, but people are like desperate. I gotta hold on to money. I don't want to part with money. I say, wow, I feel bad about even asking them because they feel that they're gonna be so deprived if they don't have it. So that's a real, real problem for me. End up doing work for free. It's not good. So the wealthy people are desperate people. You don't get happy when you're wealthy, not at all. You want more. You say, wow, I have all these things, I'm not happy, but at least I have the power to get more. And you work so hard to get more, and then you say, wow, yeah, I'm still haunted by this fear of deprivation. Where is that coming from? I don't have enough. Now, the fear of deprivation comes automatically when we desire, the desire to have more than everything. We want to have more than, we want more than everywhere, more space than everywhereness. That puts the notion that we could have less than what we deserve, that what we need. We say, well, I need more than everything. And they say, oh my gosh, if I don't get more than everything, I'll only have everything, and that won't be enough. That's death. We actually invented death, the idea that having everything is death, and having more than everything is life. And so we're pursuing this more than everything, and yet constantly this death is pursuing us. You think we're going to fall into this terrible death of merely everything. So these times right now are very depressing times, can be, because there's so much being produced in the world right now. Things. Unprecedented amount of things. And when you're in the slowdown, you're slowing down so you can see the vision of oneness. You realize you're not going to be able to attend that party. All these things, you know. And that can get to you. It can get to you. You think, I'm being deprived. I'm being deprived. I'm being deprived. I'm going to be very deprived. Now, in the past, like for instance, in Tibet or India, various places, the very few things, a few things made by hand, and that's it. And this has been going on for 1,000 years or whatever. It just goes on and on, generation to generation, just the same thing, same thing, same thing, same thing, same thing. Nothing. You have a cow, a goat, you know. Land, whatever. I mean, everything is pretty much, there's no thing that's not so many things or anything like that. So it's not so difficult to say, well, I'm just going to take it easy and meditate and contemplate and slow down, and I'm not going to be deprived of much. But in today's world, where we have, you know, what, 1,000 channels, and in the future maybe, you know, 100,000 channels, or millions of apps. Oh, I don't have this app. I don't have that app. Constant changing in technology. Phones, you know, all these different gadgets, constant new gadgets, upgrades in software, upgrades in everything. Fashion, constantly changing. You go in the store and every couple of weeks, new fashion, new fashion, new fashion, new clothes, new everything. People going vacations, going every place, doing. There's this incredible feeling that you're missing out on something. And feeling like, how can I get all these things? You know, I'm going to be deprived, and other people are getting them, I'm not. I used to go to thrift stores, and just so I could get all these things that people used to have. I didn't have any money or any way to get anything hardly. So I'd get like a shirt for 50 cents or something, and I'd get like, I have 100 shirts. just accumulates a lot of things. So I had a lot of things. I felt like, okay, I'm not so deprived, but all these people always, you know, they get the money, they get things, they're putting leaving the past behind. Oh, those fashions are passe, they're in the past. And I want to just wear like a t-shirt and shorts and tennis shoes or sandals. That's it. Same stuff for my whole life. But the pressure is so intense that, no, you've got to, you can't seem like you're dropping out of here. And in other times, you could, dropping out was cool. It was the right thing to do. Now, you know, you stick out like a sore thumb. It's incredible. If you don't keep up with the religion of things, being seen as something terrible. Driving on the roads in California, it's mind-blowing. What I could do, what I intentionally do is I look to see any old cars, any old vehicles on the road. And rarely do you ever see an old vehicle. In fact, everything you see is actually, you know, less than 10 years old. The cars, really. It's astonishing. And if you do see an old vehicle, which is very rare, it's like, whoa, look at that. What is that? What is that? So your pressure, the pressure is here. I mean, who could buy a new car? I mean, to me, that's just utterly, I can't even imagine how it's possible to buy a new car. And yet everybody has a new car here. Occasionally you see like an old van. Sometimes vans hang in there. And occasionally you see an older pickup truck, occasionally. Maybe you know, an older Toyota or something, but super rare, super rare. We went on a trip driving all the way up and down California, and we realized when we got home, we said we didn't see any old cars at all on the trip. It's like, huh? What's going on here? So the days of being a hippie, you know, are so far in the past. As far as the pressure, see, the hippies wanted to go somewhere where they could feel it's okay to drop out, it's okay to slow down, it's okay to slow down. But the thing is, they turned slowing down into a goal in itself. That they wanted to get the buzz of having slowed down. Say, yeah, I've slowed down. I'm a slow downer. I'm a hippie. And they sort of lost sight of the real goal. Because the slowing down has to actually be very intelligent and profound. It's not just about getting back to the earth and having the, yeah, I'm saving the environment, yeah, I'm doing this, I'm a hero, I'm a hippie hero. It's not about that. It's about the vision of oneness. No thingness. So you have to penetrate very clearly. You have to understand what it's all about. Really all about. It's not about taking drugs. People take drugs to slow down, a lot of people. Some do it to speed up, actually. The stimulants are so you can get more things, and then people then use drugs to slow down because they're freaking out from too much stimulation. But that's not an intelligent slowdown. It's not a persistent, consistent, clear, intelligent slowdown. The slowdown needs to be wise, wisdom. You need to live in the moment of expedient, of how can I use this moment to help me truly slow down and be okay with that and see through this whole charade of time, of this dream of more than everything, this dream of thingness, this perception of gaps everywhere that so that we could think, so we see, think we're getting some things. If we think that we live in a thing world of things, we think we call a world of things. But there are no things. There is no world, such world. There is no such world. There is no world of things anywhere. There are no things anywhere. There's not. Meaning there's nothing that is abiding outside of everywhere. Everywhere is. And so we have to allow that to, this process of mood of repentance to accept this and just look at it and say, and that slows us down, Say, okay, wait a minute, I don't want to go chasing after this and this and this. Let me just stay, you know, stay centered and all this. So those like Thoreau and Emerson, those who went Walden Pond, they went somewhere, they tried to slow their life down. That's also, you know, a tradition. the contemplatives, etc. But I find they didn't have much success. They kind of had a wistful yearning, but I find that staying in the pressure cooker, somehow that's so dissatisfying that you work at it with more intensity, seems like. Those who like go out, no, I got a cabin on the lake. Well, they might find some tranquility there, and they think, okay, this is it. I found the things that I need. I found the things that I need. See, they don't really penetrate through to the essence of the situation. Whereas here, I can say, I can't find anything that I need. I was thinking about this weekend. What do I do here? What do I do with today in the Bay Area? Nothing. I searched it on the internet so much. I can't find anything that I'm interested in doing here. Nothing. Should I go here? Anything going on? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Can't think of anything I want to do. Including sitting here, really. Nothing. There's nothing I want to do. I don't feel that there's anything I can do today that is going to make any difference whatsoever in how I feel. Not one thing. So that's like very almost depressing, right? It's like, wow. I can't think of a single thing I want to do today, and I don't think I'll ever be able to think of anything I want to do here or anywhere, actually. But certainly in the Bay Area, which everybody thinks this is the mecca of doing things. Northern California, there's no better place in the world for doing things, and yet I cannot find a single thing that I want to do. So that can be very depressing, right? If you think, wow, I got no future. But that's where then the spiritual path, you have to reinterpret that correctly, interpret it correctly. It's actually a very positive state of mind, very profound state of mind. It needs to be acknowledged as such. So I'm acknowledging everybody out there that's poor in spirit, poor, dispirited, depressed, etc. I'm acknowledging actually you're in a very profound state of mind. It's just unacknowledged as such. It's unacknowledged. The world doesn't acknowledge it. It denies it. And that's what hurts you. You feel hurt by that. That's what really depresses you. I mean, if I were to, you know, it's like the whole Bay Area, I'm sure, would completely disagree with me. Everybody here thinks that there's so much to do. And I say, there's absolutely nothing to do. What am I going to do? Walk among the giant redwoods? Is that supposed to change how I feel? No, nothing's going to change how I feel as far as thingness. Thingness never satisfies. It only gives a feeling of deprivation, actually. Deprivation, the feeling of deprivation and death and thingness go hand in hand, two sides of one coin, inseparable. Can't separate them out. One from another is impossible. So the depression comes and we think, oh my gosh, I'm always going to feel deprived because I can never get what I really want, and I can't see the seeking for things. We think we're leaving the deprivation and fear and death behind as we, in the past, as we have these, oh, what do I do today? Okay, I got something to do. We think we're leaving the stuff that didn't work behind. We're not. We're just more of the same. More of the same. More of the same. More of the same. When you realize that, you say, wow, there's nothing I can do that's going to change this feeling of deprivation, etc. However, we can heal our perception. We can have our perception healed. But we don't see gaps. We don't see things. We don't see places. We don't see events. We don't see any of that. We only see the one. As Sri Anandamayi said, I only see the one. That's all that I see. I don't see separate things at all. I see just one. Just one. That's it. Just one. Only see the one. Not more than the one. Which would be thingness. Which is a hallucination. Thingness is a hallucination. Thanks to Jesus saying that. Thingness is a hallucination. So we're literally hallucinating and then chasing after those hallucinations. And we think we're leaving fear, death, and deprivation behind. No, we're just actually building it up more intensely in our mind, which then fuels even more intense seeking. Now the danger is if you hit the brakes too hard, of course, when you hit the brakes too hard, what happens? You go into a slide, it's bad. I was in a recent situation on the road where a very, very dangerous situation arose, super unexpected on everyone's part. And I hit the brakes, but I pumped behind. I was able to keep the car from skidding or sliding. So it was a smooth slowdown, but it was still very quick, fast, intense slowdown, but it was smooth. I kept it smooth. That's what you have to do. You have to keep it smooth. Don't go into a skid. The ego tells us, oh, you want to slow down? Okay. Hits, you know, grabs the emergency brake, slams on the brakes, puts the emergency brake on, puts you into a spin, you know, and terrible. No. The slowdown needs to be intelligent. It needs to be smooth, simple, easy. And you need to work at it every day. Every day you're hitting the brakes a little harder, you're slowing down a little more, a little more, a little more. Ultimately, it will be a quick slowdown. But don't let the ego, you know, the ego will tries to sponsor, you know, severe radical slowdowns that then cause you severe problems, and then you rebound from that. You know, it's not good. I'm gonna fast. I'm gonna do breathing exercises. I'm gonna chant. I want to make a breakthrough. I want to completely, you know, I'm gonna do it right now in this weekend retreat. I'm gonna completely blow through everything and. No, that's not it. People who are oscillate, you know, they frantically pursue things, and then on the weekends they say, wow, that's like rah, so tough. I'm gonna really unwind this weekend. Let's they take drugs, have a big party, you know, and food, and we'll do chanting, and we'll go. I mean, they just, you know, try to like just slam on the brakes on the weekend or whatever, and then back to the grind, pursuing wealth, and. Satisfying the vanity of the flesh during the week. That's not the way. The way is every day you're putting on the brakes ever more, ever more, ever more, ever more. Keep it simple, keep it easy. So as I work, I'm always, every day, mindful of this whole situation and continuously working on it. As I drive, I'm taping. I have an MP3 recorder. I'm taping all day. All day I'm slowing down more and more and more and more. So the weekends it's just more of the same, more of the slowdown, more of the slowdown. Not these frantic swings back and forth. The 60s were like this frantic reaction to the corporate culture of the 40s and the 50s, the military industrial complex, the corporate structure, and frantic success, you know, need to get a things and everything. People, and then the generation just said, wow, we need to drop out of this. This is too much. And so, but it was sort of a frantic dropout. And then the rebound from that is, you know, the present times, you see it didn't work. You don't want to have a totally drastic type of breaking situation. You want to certainly break as hard as you can without going into a spin, for sure. But don't go into that spin. Those who have gone into a spin have tried to break too hard. And the way to come out of that is ease up on the brakes a little bit. Ease up a little bit. Don't try to convince the world that you're breaking. You know, I try to look, you know, normal to the world, like I'm not breaking at all. Don't draw any attention to yourself that you're breaking. don't draw attention to yourself that you're slowing down. You know, you're just a normal, hey, you know, watch the football game, sure. So, you know, so I just try to live a normal life, you know, of and seem like I'm just speeding along with everybody else. I'm sure nobody has the slightest idea that I'm slowing down, braking. No, not really at all. So it's possible, if you have mental illness, if you're really, I mean, you're struggling with all this kind of terrible stuff, what you do is you ease up on the brakes a little bit, you understand what you're doing a little better, and all this will take that edge off of what you're experiencing. Softens the edge, and just a little softening of the edge is enough for you to come out of it and say, okay, I'm going to be all right, I'm going to be all right. I just had a little too much of an edge there. I was trying to force the issue too much. It was a slowdown that was a reaction to my aggression of trying to get things, you know. And so I need to have a little better context and understanding. I need a little bit of encouragement. I need to understand that what I'm doing is right. Why is it right? And get a better overall context. There, you know, we were told to slow down here in the West, and we went to the East for help. Help East, you know, the Indian gurus so slow, everything slowed down there. Can you help us slow down? Can you help us slow down? They said, sure, we'll help you. But we really didn't understand it very well at all from the Tibetan guru, the Tibetan Rinpoches, and the Indian gurus, and all these cultures that slowing down was an art form there, but we really didn't understand it very well at all. And, you know, it doesn't translate well, actually, to our present culture. It doesn't translate very well. But in some ways it's kind of filtered through, but we had a lot of problems with that. And so what I've done my whole life is try and get a better contextual presentation of it. So we can say, aha, so that's what I've been doing. Great, that's okay. Yeah, now I see it more clearly. Anytime you translate stuff like from one culture, like Tibetan teachings, into another language, another culture, it's very problematical, actually. Very problematical. They know what they're talking about. Yes, they do. But from our culture is very different. Our situation is very, very different. The pace, I mean, they, you know, there's just no way to translate just how intense the thingness is of this juggernaut of the modern world of America, for instance, the Western world leading this incredible secular materialistic situation. You know, it's just, I mean, the wheels came off some of the Tibetan and Indian teachers, a lot of them, they couldn't handle it either. The wheels came off. So we need to have something that stands up to this situation. And for me, my whole life living in the Silicon Valley, where the epicenter of pressure, I've had to develop clarity that deals with this actual situation that's here. It's actually here. You know, you cannot run and hide from it in Tibet somewhere. You run into the Chinese, you could try to do that, and they're here too. So all this stuff is here. Manufacturing of things is here. This pressure is here. All of it is here now. There's no point in pretending that you can somehow dwell in the past. I mean, chronologically. Doesn't, you know, that's gone. But fortunately, there are those who have the approach. This approach here is what is going to work for all this pressure that is here now, the fourth dimensional pressure, absolutely. Fourth dimensional situation is here now. It's here now. And we have to be able to see through it, through and through, and break from it, and see the vision of oneness, even in the land of plenty, in the land of plenty. And that's the challenge, really, that is here right now. We don't have some challenge back 200 years ago. We have the challenge here right now in front of us, where unprecedented challenge, where literally the fourth dimension, the so-called abundance of thingness of the fourth dimension is upon us. It's like the tsunami's upon us, plain and simple. And we can do it. Absolutely, we can do it. And we will do it. Got no choice. God is upon us. And it's upon us more than we realize. I mean, it is really upon us. It is. There's no going back. We're not able to go back. It's not going to happen. So there may be some that thought, oh, we can turn the tide and go back. No, we cannot. And they may then get depressed and say, wow, I don't have the clarity or anything. Well, that's where these videos come in for those people and others. See, there is clarity about all this. Absolutely there is. I always say, A Course in Miracles was designed to deal with the severe situation that we have now. It knew that this is coming upon us. And we needed to get super contextually clear in a very abstract way that is detached from race, nationality, epic, civilization, era, place, gender, everything, you name it, that is simply very pure, pure clarity on the situation that will enable us to not get sucked into this future fantasy of thingness, of more than everything, more than everythingness, more than everywhereness, more than everything. And it's a confusion of words, of course, but that you understand what's being pointed to. We could just withstand that. We could withstand it and not get suckered into it. The idea of just being a primitive third world person or goes to some place and they have resistance to it is the biggest nonsense in the world. It's utter nonsense. That's where the hippies kind of failed. They thought, oh no, let's just go be tribal. Yeah. No. If you take those provincial people from the provinces, from the sticks, bring them to the big city, take them to the shopping mall, you know what? Very soon, they just go cuckoo and they have to have everything. And they become absolute materialistic slaves. You know, they have no resistance to it. It's like smallpox or something to them, materialistic smallpox. No, they have no resistance to it. Once they realize that these things exist and they can have them, oh my gosh, we gotta have a new purse every day, you know, a new pair of shoes. You know, they go shopping, 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 shopping. They think they're in paradise. So it's utter nonsense to think that the provincial people have some sort of resistance to all this stuff. They don't. They just don't know it exists. They don't have the means to get it, but once they find out, oh my gosh, they're in. They're all in. They're all in. So that was a huge mistake. I didn't make that mistake. I said, that's bogus. Forget it. There's no place you can go in this world that is free from the contagion of this planet. So you have to work it out where you are through pure clarity. You have to go for pure clarity. And that's what we're doing right here. All right, I've got to now pretend that I'm not hitting the brakes today. Very great. Keep it simple. Keep it clear. Keep it easy. That's it.